covering bad articles I find on the internet is a trend for me, and I have no idea why. So, the next Sideshow Com is gonna involve not only a conversation about a subject that I know a lot about, but also feel is needed since I am covering two videos. With the former being more and more frustrating to watch looking back, I feel like I can cover something, just anything I can find as a distraction. Somehow I found it. And it's on a subject I don't know a whole lot about but can look more into to feed my intrigue. I should be fine.
Just a moment. Wait. Stop talking. Excuse me, I have an announcement. Ahem. Because of the high standards we in the slideshow commentary community strive to adhere to, and as a result of the disastrous outcome of the first time an article was covered on this channel, management has decided to suggest another approach with the article in question and gameplay footage for this commentary. Several games were screened, and we chose one based on the commentary's experience with reboots, remakes, and spin-offs. Plus, this will be an excuse to show off her current gaming brain rot. Thank you.
So what are you saying?
I'm saying gameplay footage will have to be used for this video, and you'll need a different approach with this kind of material.
Huh. That makes sense. I guess I'll figure out how to use the two avatars I have for this kind of thing. They're sitting in the dressing room. Hola amigos, Raven Pines here with something completely different. So, context. RWBY is an American animated web series created by the late Monty Ohm and is currently produced under the Rooster Teeth umbrella. This past summer, an anime spinoff of the series was released on Crunchyroll, aptly named RWBY Ice Queendom. Why do I bring all this up? Well, not too long ago, a comic book-based journalism website known as Comic Book Resources, or CBR, released an article titled 10 Ways the Original RWBY is Better than Ice Queendom. I read it, and... nope, folks, I didn't like it. You'll see why as the commentary progresses. Before we get started, I want to talk about something. Ahem. Whose idea was it to approve this bullshit?
Why are you starting the commentary with a tangent?
Look, there comes a time when a commentator has to take a stand against bullshit practices at major news websites talking about nerd shit.
Nerd shit?
Yeah, nerd shit.
Pussy!
Now, with that in mind, would you say that having two different articles with conflicting main ideas by the same author on a site like CBR is a good look and not sus at all? If your answer is yes, then do yourself a favor and pick up a hobby. Because that practice needs to be nipped in the fucking bud. I'm sorry, but it's not a good look at a goddamn website that's supposed to be a reputable source for all things comic books, movies, TV shows, and anime. No, but really, this is not looking good here. Especially when you consider the fact that the article's words leaked to each other as counterpoints. Now, you could say that the author is trying to present two different perspectives, and if it was just that, I can understand. But here, it's just done very poorly. If this is the first time this has happened, then any future instance of this should be avoided unless there is a way that a countering article could be written by a different author. If this is another incident of that happening, then the people who thought it was a good idea really did a shitty job at stopping it. There is something that actually makes this even worse, that being a really poor comparison. I'll explain later. Apologies for the tangents, but I just wanted to get this off my chest. Well, never thought I'd be introduced this early. Oh well, I'm Raven the Editor 2001, nice to meet ya.
I know, such a subtle reference to an old username, jeez.
So, I want to make it clear that I'm not gonna cover the whole article, just some sections that stuck out like a sore thumb to me, so be prepared for some skipping. Don't worry, there will be context for each section that will be skipped. Before we get to the good stuff, I want to talk about the number 10 section of the article. This discusses how the Rooster Teeth voice cameos make the original RWBY more personal for Rooster Teeth fans, and how there won't be as many RT voices before in the English dub of the anime, blah blah blah. I actually looked at one of the articles linked in this section for reference. Basically, it talks about the top 10 best supporting characters in the original RWBY. That's all well and good, but the problem is this particular section in the article talks about the voice work from the folks who work with Rooster Teeth and not really expanding on that idea, much less providing examples to help drive that idea home. Like, it expects people whose knowledge of RWBY and his voice cast is slim to none to actually know this information and, I don't know, read the author's mind to see what they mean. Sure, the fans might know, but those who aren't familiar with it might not know this info right away. But wait, you might say, wouldn't it be more beneficial if you look up this kind of information yourself instead of having the author be the presenter they were supposed to be in this case? The answer is no, unless you like treasure hunts, of course. I did some digging, and I found some info about Michael Jones. Not only is he known as the voice of Sun Wukong, but he plays a major role in Achievement Hunters, Rooster Teeth's gaming division. If we're talking protagonists and not just side characters, you could also count Lindsay Jones, the voice of RWBY Rose. From what I can gather, they played a major role in Achievement Hunters as a manager at one point. There's also Barbara Dunkelman, the voice of Yang Xiaolong, who is the creative director and former community manager and marketing director for Rooster Teeth. Now, my problem with this segment isn't that it's wrong, my problem is that it's really fucking vague with what it is the author is talking about. Now, if they didn't name names for privacy reasons, or if they just didn't want to break anyone's non-disclosure agreements, I can see why that would be the case. However, for this section, it feels like something was really off. If what I said was out of line, I apologize. It's just that this segment in particular has been really bugging me since first reading. But it's done, so at least we got that out of the way. And now, our feature presentation. Yeah, use a
bitch. Number 5. The original RWBY benefits from being the first to showcase the show's unique premise. A remake that opts to repeat most of the original dialogue will always run the risk of feeling stale. This happens despite the necessity of trying to keep the original's core moments and features while offering natural improvements. The original RWBY will always be considered just that, the original. Ice Queendom has already shown that it will be introducing new plot points and ideas, but sticking to exact dialogue and other moments will always bring comparisons to the original series. Expectations will be high for Ice Queendom to move past this and establish itself with its own identity.
So, in other words, the original series did the premise first, and therefore it is better than an anime adaptation that was just establishing its ideas in the first three episodes at the time the article was published. Okie dokie then.
Hey, sorry for interrupting the video, but I just need to make a quick mention of something. Alright, check this out. So, the article was published on CBR's website on July 14th, right? And Ice Queendom was officially launched on July 3rd with the first episode, nearly 11 days apart. And if we count the second episode that's part of the official launch, it launched on July 10th. That's 4 days before the article was published. And the third episode has not been officially launched yet. And I know there was a thing with Crunchyroll with releasing the first three episodes early. An article about that will be in the description. It is by animegeek.com. It's pretty interesting when you think about it. And while it is possible that many of CBR's staff was aware of it, and some of them might even have seen the three episodes early and had it stew into their thoughts for a while, yeah, it's still a little weird that they had to rush an article like that just to get on the trend train, if you know what I mean. Just saying. Now back to our regularly scheduled program.
This is where the thing I alluded to earlier rears its ugly head. It's not really fair to compare a web series that has been dropping multiple episodes for almost a decade to an anime series that just came out. The seeds haven't been growing into seedlings yet, so you just need to be patient. A series doing a story first should not dictate its quality automatically. Execution is a thing, and a story thrives or suffers depending on how it is handled. Now, could one argue that the original executed its ideas better than Ice Queendom? I'd say not yet, so we'll have to wait and see. This will be important when we get to another section of the article and another important talking point connected to this, so just keep listening.
Number 4. Ice Queendom rushes certain aspects of the story and loses some of what made the original so great. While RWBY Ice Queendom's first three episodes do repeat much of the dialogue from the original RWBY, it also leaves out various moments of character development. This leads Ice Queendom to become rather rushed, as if it can't wait to introduce its new additions to fans. These additions are certainly a welcome and exciting change to RWBY. Unfortunately, rushing the characters' opening scenes as they arrive at Beacon and form teams takes away from cherished moments of the original.
Takes away from moments of the original how? Last time I checked, Ice Queendom is from Weiss's point of view. Like, sure, there can be workarounds where various moments from the original could possibly play a role while also having Weiss in the middle of it all. However, as an outsider looking in, I don't see how that is an issue, unless it's just not done very well. Maybe the aspects being rushed would be apparent once more episodes come out, but I doubt it. Actually, while we're on that subject, the author did say that the anime rushed some aspects from the original, those being moments of character development and the characters' opening scenes as they arrive at Beacon and form teams. Do they explain how these aspects were rushed?
God damn it, CBR.
The only episode of the anime that had any issue was episode 3, and that's because of the pacing from what I've heard. That is one genuine critique that you could give the anime adaptation. But we could just chuck that out the window in favor of bullshit that didn't even matter in the first place. I understand that they don't want to spoil anything from both iterations, but as a journalist, especially for CBR standards, it is their job to provide evidence for a positive claim. I hate it here. On God. Yeah, you's a bitch.
Number 2. The original RWBY's charm came from its stylized CGI. Viewers who are watching RWBY for the first time with Ice Queendom before going back to the original will likely pick up on the vast difference in animation style. The original series initially had very little budget to work with in comparison to the later volumes, and while it still looked impressive, the CGI approach didn't necessarily get it right every time. However, this stylized CGI is what gave RWBY its charm and character. This charm is swapped out in Ice Queendom for a certain elegance that is not especially unique when it comes to anime as a whole.
I think they're forgetting something. These two iterations are made in different mediums. Like, no shit there's a difference in animation style between the two. No shit that the modern anime style presented is elegant. No shit it isn't unique to anime. Why does it matter? Why don't we even bother with this bullshit? Anyways, we're done with this Grimm hunt here. Nothing special about the number one segment of the article except maybe a bit of advertising for Volume 9 and Ice Queendom, but I'm gonna ignore that because I am not in the mood for that debate. So, with all that said and done, the show is nearly over. Let's go back on stage for a curtain call. Congratulations, CBR, you published one of the worst articles about nerd shit that I've ever read. Like, when this whole thing reeks of seeking confirmation bias from anyone agreeing with the idea the article is presenting without question, you know it's bad journalism. Now, before you mention anything about Fox News or CNN being worse in that department, they're not even part of the discussion, so why does that matter? It's not bad journalism from CBR because it's disagreeable, it's just bad journalism by design. Point blank period. This whole discussion in the article about Ice Queendom in the original RWBY had me thinking about other discussions regarding reboots, remakes, and spinoffs in media in general. Hell, there's a reason why I used footage from my gameplay of the Final Fantasy VII Remake. This kind of discussion has intrigued me for a while now. When talking about stuff like this, it's important to understand that it's not just fans of the original iteration of any series that are often looking at reboots, remakes, and spinoffs of the same property. There are also newcomers, returning fans, and outsiders looking in. So just saying the original version did its premise first is just archaic thinking. Here's a quick lesson to my audience before we wrap this up. If something about a discussion doesn't feel right, you have the freedom to call that out. You can choose to leave the discussion if you wish, but I feel that having healthy and productive discussions on what people like and dislike in media is a better alternative to just voicing an opinion and just leaving it at that while being toxic about it. Hopefully this helps. If not, well, at least I hope this entertained you all. That's all, folks. Until next time, this is Raven Pine saying take care and be kind to one another. Adios!